Good morning, everyone. Hello, how are we? Good to see you. It's Sunday again. I love Sundays. Who loves Sundays? Come on. It's great to be together. Hope you are well. If you're streaming in today, you are very welcome. Hope you have had a great week. We had a great day on Friday with some of our young people meeting together. And obviously, during this time, we'd usually go away with a Christian festival. But sadly, we couldn't do that. But we gathered together watching Limitless, the National Youth Ministry online. And we went to an aqua park. Do you know what an aqua park is? Basically a lake with a load of inflatables and you just go absolutely crazy. So we had fun, didn't we, Caitlin? Yeah, it was great. So great to gather with our young people on Friday. Continue to keep them in your prayers. We've got an amazing youth ministry and it's just great to gather with them. But great to gather with you today and hope you're doing well. I wonder if you'd stand with me this morning. We're going to worship God. We're going to give our all for him. That's why we gather together this morning. He has united us together as a church family, and he wants to meet with us today, and he wants to speak to us. That's exciting, isn't it? That God wants to speak to us today. Let's have our hearts open to him, and I just want to say this promise over us. It says in the Bible, Psalm 37, take delight in the Lord. Delight yourselves in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. What a promise. Take delight in the Lord. And you might think this morning, well, I'm struggling to take delight in the Lord because of everything else, what's going on around me, difficult circumstances that I'm facing. How do I take delight in the Lord through all of that? Get rid of the circumstances and fix your eyes on Jesus and know that he is God, that he is good. Know what he has done for you. He has come here on earth, giving himself for us, dying on a cross so that we can have a relationship with him today. What an amazing God we have. Take delight in the Lord and he will give you the desires of your heart. What a good God we have. So let's pray this morning. Lord Jesus, we thank you for who you are. Thank you that you are here with us today. Thank you that you never leave us nor forsake us. And thank you today that we can delight in you because of who you are, because of your goodness, your faithfulness, your love, your mercies, which are new every single day, your grace, which is given to us constantly, overflowing in our lives, Lord. We take delight in you because of who you are, Jesus Christ. And we thank you for that promise as we take delight in you, that you give the desires of our heart. What a good God you are. And we give our all for you today. We worship you, Lord Jesus, our Lord, our God, and our Savior. In your mighty name, amen. 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 Let's worship together.
Hallelujah. Let's praise him. It's great to be with you this morning. Let's lift our hands, let's lift our voices in praise and worship of our God.
Praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't.
what's broken inside me. Just one word and you revive every dream. One touch, I feel the power of heaven. Just one touch, my eyes were open to see. My heart can't help but believe. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a mountain that He can't move. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can do. There's nothing. There's nothing that our God can do. There's not a prison wall He can't break through. Yes. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can do.
Together now, this is called My Testimony. It's a great declaration of what God has done for us. The lyrics are going to be on the screen. Join in if you can. Thank you.
I saw Satan fall like lightning. I saw darkness run for cover. But the miracle that I just can't get over. My name is registered in heaven. I believe in signs and wonders. I have resurrection power. Still the miracle that I just can't get over. My name is registered in heaven. Yeah, my praise.
belongs to you forever. This is my testimony from death to life. 'Cause grace rewrote my story, I'll testify. By Jesus Christ the righteous, I'm justified. This is my testimony, this is my testimony. Oh, 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 oh. Sons and daughters, born with blood and washed in water, sing the praises of the Spirit, Son and Father. Our God will finish what He started. Yes, our God will finish what He started.
Oh, this is my testimony.
This is my testimony from death to life. 'Cause grace rewrote my story, I'll testify. By Jesus Christ the righteous, I'm justified. This is my testimony, this is my testimony. Oh, 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 oh.
Going to declare this out together, church. The lyrics are going to be on the screen. If I'm not dead, you're not done. It's just a declaration that God can do immeasurably more than we can ask or imagine, and He's still working today. He's still working through us. Let's sing it together. If I'm not dead,
if I'm not dead, you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. This is my testimony from death to life. 'Cause grace rewrote my story, I'll testify. By Jesus Christ the righteous, I'm justified. This is my testimony. This is my testimony from death to life. 'Cause grace rewrote my story, I'll testify. By Jesus Christ the righteous, I'm justified. This is my testimony. This is my testimony. Oh, 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 oh.
My comforter, my all in all.
praise. No matter what we may be going through, what is facing us, Lord, you deserve the highest praise, and you are worthy of every song that we could ever sing. You're worthy of all the praise that we could ever bring. Jesus, you're worthy of every breath that's in my body, Lord, in our bodies today. Lord, you are worthy. Thank you, Lord. Jesus. Worthy, Lord.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing. You're worthy of all the praise we could ever bring.
There is no
you, Lord. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is made complete in us. We know that we live in him and he in us, because he has given us of his Spirit. And we have seen and testified that the Father has sent his Son to be the Savior of the world. If anyone acknowledges that Jesus is the Son of God, God lives in him and he in God. And so we know and rely on the love God has for us. God is love. Whoever lives in love lives in God and God in him. In this way, love is made complete among us, so that we will have confidence on the day of judgment, because in this world we are like him. There is no fear in love, but perfect love drives out fear, because fear has to do with punishment. The one who fears is not made perfect in love. We love because he first loved us. If anyone says, I love God, yet hates his brother, he is a liar. For anyone who does not love his brother whom he has seen cannot love God whom he has not seen. And he has given us this command: whoever loves God must also love his brother. I will build my life on this love, the love that has been poured out into each and every one of us. This is love, that God first loved us. Thank you, Jesus, that you first loved me. Thank you that you came and died for me because of love. Thank you, that's your very nature. It's not just your character, it's your nature. It is love. You are love. Thank you that if we are to find love, we just need to look at the very person of Jesus, and that is what we need to build our life upon. We can search for many things in this world, search for belonging, search for being loved, but the real heart of it all is coming to the very person of Jesus Christ, who came and showed what love really is. And that's what he calls us to build our life upon, right on his name, Jesus Christ. Build your life on Jesus Christ. Be obedient to what he calls us to do. Love one another. Let's just sing this refrain again. I will build my life.
I will build,
yes, Lord,
my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be, shaken.
Yes, Lord. Jesus, for who you are in our lives. We worship you today. And may we continue to follow you, our good shepherd, the one who laid his life down for his sheep. Come come and speak to us today. Lord Jesus, in your mighty name. Amen. Amen. Thank you, worship team, for leading us this morning. So good. Amazing to just be with one another and in the presence of God this morning. He is here, is with us, wants to speak to us, and Pastor Andy is going to bring the word in just a moment. Before I invite him, though, I'm going to invite Jenny up now, and she's got some news to share with us. But before we Jenny comes up, just a few things to be aware of. As you know, the midweek program in August kind of is stripped back a little bit as we look to plan of what September looks like going forward. And so, yeah, midweek prayer meetings, life groups are just being on hold for the moment. But please do meet with one another, socialize with the church family, meet with your friends and just be together. That would be great as we continue to build up one another and encourage one another. Some exciting news and good news is that last Sunday, I was actually at Sturchley Community Church, where, as you know, Derby City Church, from a number of years ago, we had Matthew Atkins here, the assistant pastor. He went and back to his home church and started to take the lead there. I'm pleased to say he is now a married man. Woo! That's good, isn't it? So he's done very well, and so it's amazing that he's now married. So I was there last Sunday preaching at his church, and that was really, really good. So Jenny, come and join me. If you get a microphone, that would help. There we go. This is Jenny.
Hello.
Hello, Jenny.
Hello.
How are you?
I'm all right, thanks.
Good.
A little bit nervous.
Don't be nervous. It's just people. And... you know, they're in masks as well, so, yeah, funny looking, isn't it? Lovely, I mean, you all look beautiful. Jenny, tell us a little bit about you. Like, how did you come to Derby City Church, and what led you to Derby City Church as well? Tell us a little bit about yourself.
Okay, yeah, so I moved to Derby for work. I transferred over from our London office, and I've been here for around 5 years now.
Wow, 5 years. Yeah. And what is it you do work-wise?
What is it I do work? I help government bodies buy trains.
Wow.
So engineering consultancy.
Nice. Yeah. Cool. And you, like you say, you've been part of the church for 5 years, and you've been involved in lots of different areas of the life of the church, in ministries. You've been helping us on sound.
Yeah.
And that's been a challenge over the year, hasn't it?
Yeah, it's all very different now. We're going live, so we normally need 2 people on a Sunday.
Yeah.
So if anyone's interested in doing sound, that'd be great.
That's great. A little bit of a promo there. honestly, it's been an absolute head mash trying to get like live stream sound working. We've got a cupboard in there, haven't we? With I think there's someone in there, isn't there?
Like, yeah, there's like a little studio.
Having a live stream mix going on. So it's all good, but you've been a part of making it happen. And you've also helped me out with young adults over the year as well, haven't you?
Yeah. So we've been doing young adult. I think we went every week during the first part of lockdown, and then now we're back to young adults every 2 weeks. So that's been really good to hang out with everyone. Yeah.
And just a question, you've been very much involved in serving. Why do you serve in the life of Derby City Church? Obviously, you've got a gifting on sound, and you've helped lead in young adults. Why serve in the life of the church?
I don't know. I feel like it's just what we were made to do, to like serve one another,
Amazing.
Be with one another, be part of a team, sort of work for God, really.
So, amazing.
Yeah.
Love it. And there's so much joy in serving as well, isn't there?
Yeah, no, I love it.
Like, you might think like serving, oh, it's hard work and it's a chore, but actually we have a good laugh, don't we? I mean, even when things go wrong, you just got to laugh through it, you know, because you got to laugh or you cry, and I'd rather laugh. So, but you've been amazing in just helping us out with the young adults and with the sound team. But I'm absolutely gutted, Jenny, and I'm really, really sad because you're leaving us.
I am. For a little while.
For a little while. Tell us a little bit about this, where you're going, why you're leaving, why, and yeah, tell us a little bit why.
Yeah, so I've been given an opportunity to work in Toronto in Canada. They're buying some new trams, so helping out with that with work. So same company, same job, but in a new place.
Great.
So on a 2-year placement, and then after that, I'll be back in Derby.
Amazing. And we're going to miss you over the next 2 years for sure. But I was wondering if, as a church family, we can pray for Jenny. Maybe can we just stand? Just if you like to stretch out your hand over her, just a way of lifting her to the Lord, that would be great. Those of you streaming online, let's just bless her as she goes into a new place. It can be scary going across overseas, but let's just pray the blessing of God over her over these next couple of years as she goes out there to Toronto. But let's pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you so much for Jenny. Thank you for her heart, for you, for her heart, for serving other people. And we pray for a great blessing over her as she goes out into her work. I pray for protection around her. Be with her so close, Lord Jesus. May she knows your presence in every situation she goes through in this transition, in just preparing to live out there over the next couple of years. But we thank you for her. Thank you for what she's given here in the life of the church for the last 5 years, how she's just poured herself out into this church, into serving you and other people. But we pray, Lord Jesus, that you will lift her, fill her anew with your presence, with your spirit, and may she go out there with boldness, knowing that you are with her and that you will never leave her nor forsake her. Thank you for her and the blessing that she has been to so many people. But we commit her to you, Lord Jesus, as she goes on this next chapter for the next couple of years. And we pray that you'll bring her back safely in your mighty name. Amen. Amen. Can we give a round of applause for Jenny? Amazing. Thank you. Thank you. Please take your seats. And I'm now going to invite, I'll get you thing, the boss up. You can take your visor off as well. Also, if you're streaming in for the first time with us today, maybe coming into the building for the first time, you are very welcome. Please do connect with us. We'd like to hear from them, wouldn't we?
Yes, we would. So
you can send an email, say hi at derbycitychurch.co.uk. And or just come and speak to us, because we're quite friendly, aren't we?
Well, I am. I don't know about you.
You're honestly.
But anyway, no, lovely to see you. I know there's new people in the building, so it's your first time here. So God bless you, and we really do welcome you. And Jenny, I'm really sorry that you're going, because I've not really got to know you yet, and you seem such a lovely person. But I know that God has not planned for you to go to Toronto just to do stuff with trains and trams. Really believe that God's got a purpose for you, far higher than that, even though that's important. And know that perhaps you'll be training other people in the faith and in service as well. So thank you for all that you've done for us. But we will miss you. But, you know, hopefully we will see you back. Really pray that. So God bless you. Turn, if you would, to the book of 2 Timothy. Interesting book, interesting situation that Paul is in when he's writing the book of 2 Timothy. And I really want you to imagine this scene, actually, as Paul is writing this particular letter to the young man, Timothy. He's got high hopes for Timothy. He really wants him to be stirred up in the faith and to lead well. And he's full of really good instruction for Timothy, as Timothy is going to be a pastor in Ephesus. And Paul, where he is at that particular time, he's under arrest. He's under arrest from the Romans. He's under threat. His life is threatened. He's getting on a bit by this time, and so he's thinking about succession, handing over young men like Timothy, and really stirring them up. He who knows? He might be put to death, and so he's probably got that looming in his mind as well. And he's under house arrest. I don't know how difficult that was. I'm sure that was very difficult for somebody who had an apostolic call. And I don't know what the conditions were like. Probably pretty basic. He probably wasn't allowed certain luxuries or anything like that. But in the situation that he found himself, he could have some help. And so it's Paul that's actually dictating this letter, but it's not Paul that's actually writing this letter, which is quite interesting when I want you to imagine this scenario. We know from Scripture, Paul seemed to have a problem with his eyesight. He talks about his writing being really large, and that's how you can tell his writing. And perhaps his writing was large because his eyesight was pretty poor. And yet Paul wrote a lot. But in this particular juncture of his life, he had got help. The doctor, Luke, had given up his time, probably given up his career, his practice as a doctor. And he joined Paul in the house arrest situation. So he'd given up his freedom and gone to help Paul. And it was Paul that was dictating the letter, but Luke was scribing it. And this is really interesting as you read this particular passage. So if we get to 2 Timothy 4, I just want you to imagine this scene. Imagine yourself in Luke's situation, if you like. You're Luke, and Paul's dictating this to you. And it's great stuff. Verse 1 of chapter 4 says this, "And so I solemnly urge you before God and before Christ Jesus, who will someday judge the living and the dead, when he appears to set up his kingdom, preach the word of God. Be persistent, whether the time is favorable or not." Some versions say in season or out of season. "Patiently correct, rebuke, and encourage your people with good teaching. For a time is coming when people will no longer listen to right teaching. They will follow their own desires and will look for teachers who will tell them whatever they want to hear. They will reject the truth and follow strange myths. But you should keep a clear mind in every situation. Don't be afraid of suffering for the Lord. Work at bringing others to Christ. Complete the ministry God has given you. As for me, my life has already been poured out as an offering to God. The time of my death is near. I have fought a good fight. I have finished the race. I have remained faithful. And now the prize awaits me, the crown of righteousness that the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on the day of his return. And the prize is not just for me, but for all who eagerly look forward to his glorious return. Please come as soon as you can." He's talking to Timothy. "Demas has deserted me because he loves the things of this life and has gone to Thessalonica. Crescens has gone to Galatia, and Titus has gone to Dalmatia. Only Luke is with me. Bring Mark with you when you come, for he is helpful to me. I sent Tychicus to Ephesus, and when you come, be sure to bring the coat I left with Carpus at Troas. Also, bring my books, and especially my papers." You know, we sang that song, didn't we, right at the very beginning of our worship, which had the line in it, "Just one word, just one word." And language is an amazing thing. We moan about the English language, don't we, because we say it doesn't describe things as well as what other languages describe it. But even in the English language, it's amazing how even the small words mean so much. If someone says to you, "No," they mean no. That's quite a powerful word, even though it be a small word. If a little child says, "Why?" Well, that could begin a whole conversation about whatever they're wondering about at that particular time. The word "if" is used in Scripture an awful lot. "If" means such a lot. And there's one word today that I want us to really home in on, and it's the word "only." Only. Like I said, imagine the scene. You're Luke. You've given up your career, your job. You've joined Paul under house arrest. You're in a place of restriction. you've given up your freedom and you're with Paul, and Paul's dictating this letter to you, and you're scribbling away, and he's coming out with all this wonderful instruction, and you're trying to keep every word down that he writes. You're trying to be faithful to everything that the apostle says. And then the apostle says, Demas has left me. Other people have gone here, there, and everywhere. There's only Luke with me. Get Mark because he's helpful to me. How does that sound if you're Luke? There's only Luke with me. Get Mark because he's really helpful to me. If you were Luke, what would you be thinking at that particular time? Only Luke. Only Luke. Well, he's an apostle, but he's got a bit of a cheek, hasn't he? You know, Luke was a doctor, an educated man. He knew his stuff, and he'd given up his freedom. He was a skillful guy. And here's the apostle Paul. I wonder if Luke ever had an argument with Paul. I wonder if Luke felt like having an argument with Paul sometimes. And the words of Paul could have been quite cutting, quite diminishing, quite destroying for Luke. We don't know what Paul meant. He may not have meant it in that way. But, you know, sometimes people say stuff to us, they don't really mean it that way, but we receive it that way, don't we? And I'm sure that maybe in Luke's position, when he'd given up all his freedom and everything like that, the word only was quite powerful in his situation. Words have power. Our words have power. That's why we've got to be careful about what we say. We've gone through a bit of a series about the one another's, haven't we? And we've talked about loving one another, forgiving one another, admonishing one another. We've talked about all those things in the one another's. I think we should be careful what we say to one another, because words are really powerful. We sometimes say those things about ourselves. If you look at Jeremiah chapter 1, Jeremiah chapter 1 is when the call of God comes to Jeremiah, this young man. And it says this in verse 4, the word of the Lord came to me saying, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I set you apart. I appointed you as a prophet to the nations. If God said that to you, how powerful would that be in your life? But Jeremiah's reply is this, alas, sovereign Lord, I said, I do not know how to speak, and I am only a child, he says. Some versions says, I'm too young. I'm only a child. Why are you bringing this calling to me? Jeremiah, his words about himself were so limiting, were so diminishing. And that's interesting, because sometimes we're like that because we're trying to be humble. But Jeremiah wasn't trying to be humble here. He was trying to limit what God was putting on his life. God was calling him. God was saying, I knew you before you were formed. God was using the words of Psalm 139 when David says, you knew me when I was in my mother's womb. You formed me. You knitted me together. What he was saying was, Jeremiah, there's a tremendous significance on your life. I'm calling you to be a messenger to not just one nation, but to the nations of the world. How did Jeremiah? Well, Jeremiah didn't know that we would be talking about Jeremiah even now, centuries later. That's because he was a messenger to the nations. And God the Father was encouraging Jeremiah of the importance of his life. Even before I formed you, I chose you. And yet, that's a momentous truth, but Jeremiah cut it off straight away with two really feeble excuses. First of all, well, I'm not able to speak, Lord. Secondly, I'm only a child. I am only a child. You know, it's interesting because God doesn't instantly respond to the fact that Jeremiah says, I'm not able to speak. That's Jeremiah's first excuse, but God doesn't say anything about that first excuse at that moment. But when God hears the second excuse, I'm only a child, straight away God says, do not say, I am only a child. How many people know that when God says do not, he's not asking us, he's not requesting us, he's commanding us. Do not murder, do not commit adultery, do not lie. They're all commands. Do not say, I am only a child. Do not say it, because what you're doing, you're limiting it. You're limiting yourself. You're limiting my calling on your life. He then goes on to say, I'll give you the words to say. If you limit yourself and what I'm putting on your life, then you're automatically going to limit the power of your words. But if you don't limit what is on your life, you're not going to put limits on what you say or what you say in my name. And that's exactly what God was doing. It wasn't even worth an answer at first when he said, I'm not able to speak, because of course he was. He was speaking right there and then, but he was going to be a messenger. God had told him, do not use the word only. When you look the word only up in a dictionary, it says this, it's derived from only. It means solitary. It means on its own. And when you think about that, what it means, no wonder God said, don't use it. Don't use it. Jeremiah could not say this in any means. God was saying to him, I knew you before you were even born. So how can you be on your own? How can you be solitary? How can you be one? You're not. I am with you. I will be with you. I was with you before you were born. And now I will give you a commission that will mean that I will go with you. I will always be with you. Friends, if you're a believer this morning, if you follow Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you can never say that you are on your own. The devil might try to intimidate you and say you're on your own or make you feel that you're on your own, but you are never on your own. Just like God promised Joshua when he was taken over from Moses to lead the children of Israel, he said, I will never leave you and I will never forsake you. That's what God is saying to every single one of us. It was what he was saying to Jeremiah. It's what he's saying to us right now. I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. Verse 8 says this, do not be afraid of them, for I am with you. I will rescue you, declares the Lord. And he's saying that to every single one of us. God will take us into situations where we might be afraid humanly, but we will never be on our own. He's with us. He never leaves us. Even in foolish situations, he never leaves us. When you think about the characters in the Bible, Jonah ran away from God. Did God go the opposite direction? God was with him all the time. Elijah, even though he'd done mighty miracles in God's name, the next minute he was in hiding. He was in a cave. He was fearing for his life, but God had not left him. God was with him. Samson was with a prostitute, but God was there. God was there. He wasn't pleased, but God was there. Paul was in prison. David, he was all over the place, was David, but David wrote these words, where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. Do you see what God's trying to say to us this morning? You are never on your own. He is always there. He is always there with you. We cannot use the excuse of being only anything, because only means that you're on your own. When I had one of my fastest motorbikes, there was two guys in the Leeds church who were really concerned about me on my motorbike, and they bought me a sticker. It was actually a bumper sticker, and motorbikes don't have bumpers, but anyway. And on the sticker, it had a picture of a speeding car and angels jumping off the car. And it said on the sticker, don't go above 70 miles an hour because the angels jump off. And I know what they were trying to say. Don't go too fast, Andy. Be careful. do you know what? The angels might jump off at 70 miles an hour, but God stays with you because God never leaves you. That's not a license to go above 70 miles an hour, but that's the truth because God never leaves us. Even when we put ourselves in foolish situations, God's always there. That's why way back when I first came here, we talked about being the temple of the Holy Spirit. Of course we're the temple of the Holy Spirit. God wants us to live our lives right. He doesn't want us to waste our lives. He doesn't want to put our lives in danger. Neither does he want us to use our bodies in ways that he doesn't want us, because he is with us all the time. His Holy Spirit is in us. We're the temple of the Holy Spirit. Friends, do not say, I am only anything, because it will limit you. It will limit the power of God in your life, not because God's away from you, but because your spirit is not responding to God's Holy Spirit. In 1 Samuel 17, we read a very, very well-known passage. And in verse 32, we see, 1 Samuel 17:32, we see the story of David, and he's come to the battlefield to his brothers. He's brought them some food. And he's amazed because the armies of Israel are quivering because this giant of an oaf, Goliath, is threatening them. And he's coming out and he's intimidating them every day. And this giant is saying, send one man to come and fight for all you. I'll fight for the Philistines and you can send a man that will fight for Israel. And David is gobsmacked that no one is coming out. No one's volunteering. And so he goes and says, I will fight this giant. I will fight this giant. So quickly, he's summoned to the king's tent. He's summoned to Saul's tent. And it says this in verse 32 of 1 Samuel 17. David said to Saul, let no one lose heart on account of this Philistine. Your servant will go and fight him. Saul replied, you're not able to go and fight against this Philistine and fight him. You're only a young man, and he's a warrior. He's been a warrior from his youth. Actually, Saul's talking a load of rubbish, because what Saul's saying is, well, Goliath started when he was young, but you can't go because you're only young. That's the enemy. That's the enemy. The enemy will tie himself in knots if you let him. But what Saul was trying to do was limit what God could do in David's life. David was confident in God. David wasn't going to let Saul say, you're only, because David knew he wasn't on his own. When he faced that giant Goliath, he went before Goliath and he said, I don't come against you in my own strength. I come against you in the name of the Lord of the armies of Israel. He knew who was with him right from the very beginning. David knew who was with him. Even though this young shepherd boy had gone there, he knew that this Goliath was no match for him. And so even when Goliath threw down this gauntlet, David knew he could fight him because he knew he wasn't alone. He could go out and he could fight. This backslidden king, Saul, he wasn't going to stifle the faith of this young believer. There was no, he wasn't in a position to tell David that he couldn't do anything. He was certainly out of order saying that David was only a boy. Yes, he was young. But one of the commentators says this, but a young man filled with God is more than a match for any giant. That's true. No matter how young you are, no matter how insignificant you feel, if God is with you, you are a match for any giant in your life. Friends, don't let anyone speak faith-killing words over your life. Don't speak them over your own life, and don't allow anybody being led by the enemy to speak them over your life. Don't let anyone say, you're too young. Don't let anybody say, oh, you're only an old person. Plenty of old people got used in the Bible, in Scripture. Don't let anyone say, you've only got a few qualifications. Whatever your qualifications. God can use you to do mighty things. Don't let anyone say you're only good for small things. God might have big things in store for you. Don't let anyone say you're only from the rough end of town. Because God can elevate you to be in palaces, to change leaders' decisions. With God, all things are possible. Who said that? Mary. Mary, insignificant, and yet God chose her to bear his son. You may be facing your biggest giant, like David was, right now. The enemy might be intimidating you and saying you're only this and you're only that. Don't allow him to diminish what you are in God. You are a child of God. You are called by him. You're commissioned by him. His spirit lives in you. In Matthew 14, we have an interesting situation because Jesus is teaching the crowds, and he's been teaching them for some while, and people are getting, well, the sun is going down and people are getting a little bit hungry, and the disciples are wondering how long is Jesus going to go on for, because they're getting hungry as well, the men, the fishermen. And they say to Jesus, let's wrap up now. Let's send the people away to go and get some food, because it's time that we all ate. And Jesus said, why don't you feed them? And the disciples say in Matthew 14, verse 17, well, we only have 5 loaves and 2 fish. That word only really stirs Jesus up, doesn't it? It gets Jesus going. And I can imagine Jesus hearing that word and thinking, that's that word again. That's that word again. Only. That limiting word. I'll show you. And Jesus took the bread and he took the fish and he started to break it. And we know that he fed 5,000 men and thousands of women and children that day. And there was baskets left over. The disciples were trying to limit what Jesus could do. But we know, whatever the situation, if Jesus is there, there is no limit. Miracles can happen. Jesus can do anything in situations. And he doesn't want you to limit that in any way, shape, or form. The church that I've been at for 25 years back in Leeds was very similar to this church, in city centre location, old building, starting to show its age in many, many ways. And we were starting to look for other places that God might be leading us to, bigger spaces. And funds were limited. And we knew that we were going to have to raise quite a lot of money if we wanted to move. But the building itself, well, it was city centre. It was worth quite a lot of money. It was worth about £1 million. We had it valued. That's quite a lot of money. One day it was worth £1 million, which was, you know, quite a lot of money. But weren't going to buy you much in terms of like a bigger space. So we started to pray. And we started to pray and we said, God, if you want us to move out of this place, then you have to provide. As time went on, Leeds City Council decided that they were going to develop a whole new shopping centre and knock down all the area of town. And one day, the building, very much like this building, was worth £1 million. And when the developers came to negotiate and ask if we would be willing to enter into negotiation, the first question we asked was, well, what sort of sum are you thinking about? And they said, well, round about £8.9 million. What do you think we said? What? Okay, we'll talk. You see, on the face of it, the building only looked to be a certain value. God had other plans. God had other ways. And with Jesus in a situation, things can be multiplied amazingly. You know, we as a church need to not limit what God can do in us, through us, amongst us, as individuals, as corporate people gathered together. Don't let anyone say that you are only anything. Don't say it about yourself. In any situation that you have, don't think, I've only got this. Always think, But with Jesus, this can be multiplied. Christians should never use the word only. But there is an exception. There is an exception. John chapter 3, verse 16 says this. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son. His only begotten Son. Jesus came. God gave his Son. It was only Jesus on his own that could die on the cross for you and I. It was only Jesus who could take the full burden of the sin of this world. Your sin, my sin, the sins of the world. It was only Jesus who could do it. Nothing in us, no other person, no other great guru or teacher, only God's Son could die for us. It was only God's Son who was spotless enough to make that sacrifice. And it was only God's Son who could be raised to life, to live again. Only begotten Son. Only in that situation can you use the word only. There's no other way, says Jesus. I am the way, the truth, and the life. Only you can come through me to the Father. And I don't know where you're at today. I don't know whether you know Jesus as your Lord and Savior. I don't know whether you've been living a life of limit and you've been feeling insignificant all your life and downtrodden and the enemy has had a field day with you. I want you to know today that only Jesus died for you. I want you today to know that only he could do something about your sin. I want you to know today that like Jeremiah, God's got a calling on your life. He's got a calling on your life to take you on to far greater things, far better things. That you might think that you had a limit on your life, but you haven't. With Jesus in your life, there's no limit, no limit. And maybe you today, maybe you online right now, are feeling the Holy Spirit speaking to you, saying, accept that Jesus died for your sin today. Accept him as your Lord and Savior. Don't put limits on your life. Don't even think, well, God can save everybody else, but he can't save me because I'm that worst sinner. Jesus died for you. He died for you and he died for me. Let's bow our heads today. Might be that you've lived a life of limit, that you've allowed the enemy to limit your life. And right now, Jesus, by his Holy Spirit, is speaking to you and saying, I've come to set you free. Set you free from sin, your sin, but set you free also from those limiting factors of the enemy and other people and what you say about your life. And right now, you can come to him in faith, in sincerity, and say, Lord, forgive me. Forgive me of my sin. Forgive me of the ways that I have limited myself and thinking. Come into my life. Come into my life. Set me free from my sin. And as I give my life to you, take me on to far bigger and better and more miraculous things that you can do in my life. Father, I pray today, Lord, that if anyone's listening today, Lord, that they know that they have sin in their life and they want to get right with you. Lord, I pray that they would come to a place in their life where they would ask you sincerely and humbly to forgive them. Father, I also pray that they would not live a life with anyone putting limits on their life, with themselves putting limits on their life, with situations putting the limit on their life. Lord, would they come to the realization right now, would their eyes be open to the God who puts no limits on and sets them free. Lord, in Jesus' name. If you want to give your life to Jesus, I'd encourage you right now to just open your heart to him. Think about this word today. Examine all about Jesus if you want. Read the word. Read about his crucifixion. Know that he died for you. And even if you were the only person in the world, he would have come and he would have died for you. Give your life to him. Don't live a life of limit any longer. And if you want to talk to Dan or I or a Christian in your life today, don't let the enemy steal that away. Talk to them today and say, I want to give my life to Jesus today. I want to start a new life of no limit today. We're going to sing a song. And it's about the fact that we can't save ourselves. Only Jesus can save us. So let's hand over to the band. Thanks, Ben.
Will you stand if you're able, church? Let's sing together, Who, O Lord? Who, O Lord, could save themselves? Their own soul could heal? Our shame was deeper than the sea. Your grace is deeper still. You alone can rescue. You alone can save. You alone can lift us from the grave. You came down to find us. Led us out of death. To you alone belongs the highest praise. Only you, Lord. You, O Lord, have made a way. The great divide you heal. For when were far away, your love grows further still. Yes, your love went further still. You alone, alone can rescue. You alone can, only you, you alone can lift us from the grave. Jesus, you came down to find us, led us out of death. To you alone belongs the highest praise. Yes, you alone can rescue. You alone can save. You alone can lift us from the grave. You came down to find us, led us out of death. To you alone belongs the highest praise. To you alone belongs the highest praise. Up our eyes, lift up our eyes, you're the giver of life. We lift up our eyes, lift up our eyes, you're the giver of life. Lift up our eyes, lift up our eyes, you're the giver of life. We lift up our eyes, lift up our eyes, you're the giver of life. Lift him up today, we lift up our eyes, you're the giver of life. Only you, we lift up our eyes, lift up our eyes, you're the giver of life. We lift up our eyes, lift up our eyes, you're the giver of life. We lift up our eyes, lift up our eyes, you're the giver of life. And you alone can rescue, you alone can save. You alone can lift us from the grave. You came down to find us, led us out of death. To you alone belongs the highest. You alone can rescue. You alone can rescue. You alone can save. You alone can lift us from grave. You came down to find us, led us out of death. To you alone belongs the highest. To you
belongs. To you alone belongs the highest. Only you, Jesus, belongs the highest praise.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. So, Father, we thank you for speaking to us so powerfully this morning. And we thank you for who you are in our lives. Thank you that we can just fix our eyes on you, Jesus. Help us not to limit ourselves, but to fix our eyes on you and just look to only you, Jesus Christ, who can change us, transform us, bring our life from death to life. We give you all the praise and all the glory today. Thank you for who you are. Be with us as we go into our weeks, and may we honor you and give you all the glory wherever we go. In your mighty name, amen. Amen. Thank you so much for being with us today. If you did receive Jesus into your life and want to find out more, then please do come and speak to us. We'd love to connect with you. Another way that we do worship God is through our finances as well. There'll be a bucket as you leave the building today. And if you want to give online, you can do that. Just check our website. I also do apologize to people streaming in today. You might not actually be able to hear this because I believe there's been a poor connection. But we'll try and get that sorted for next week. But sorry about that. But have a great week, and we'll see you soon. Take care and God bless.